Okay, good morning. Today is Thursday, August 22, 2024, and this will be class number 9 in the series Lynchy and Radical Freedom. Reading through the record of pilgrimages in the Sasaki et al. Team translation of Lynchy Lu. Lynchy as the teacher, Lu as the records of Lynchy. In the section, record of the pilgrimages, actually, after this, there are 22 chapters, you can say, in the record of pilgrimages. We're on number 5 today, taking our time. And after that, I probably will swing back into what the section of the book called Critical Examinations, which again is full of his dialogues or dialogue interactions, not just straight lecture. The first portion is discourses, and the second, Critical Examinations, and the third is called Record of Pilgrimages. The pilgrimages are very interesting. You can see his evolution and his interaction on the road, like Zatoichi on the road. Lynchy and Zatoichi have a something similar to me also. Zatoichi from the 1960s, not the later versions of that character. And so I will go through these record of pilgrimages, which go right to his dying day, his Parinibbana, or whatever it was, when he signed off and consciously left his body, and that was it for the lifetime. Probably in his late 50s or early 60s, actually. And then probably go back to critical examinations, and we can see more dialogues. Some of this will be incomprehensible. I can't, confirm that I have complete and accurate understandings. We can, I think, understand what enlightenment looks like by to some degree by the record of his interactions on pilgrimage and then, in the home temple or when he was a teacher in his own Linchi temple. What you'll see is that there is the literal. There are several meaning levels of meaning in play here. As I said yesterday, class 8, Madhyamaka, middle way philosophy from Nagarjuna and Asanga, talking about Buddha Dhamma, the cardinal principle, as being neither affirmation nor negation, reality being not, enlightenment as freedom from ignorance and craving and illusion, freedom thus from karmic creation, from creating karma. I mean, what is enlightenment? Enlightenment now. What is enlightenment? Well, there are, you can say, levels of enlightenment, there are stages of enlightenment, there is the difference between, awakenings along the way and complete and perfect enlightenment at the end. Complete and perfect enlightenment at the end, obviously, is freedom from all reincarnation in the 31 planes or 7 densities, which is the same, which is Triloka, 3 loka, or Kama loka, Rupa loka, Arupa loka, which is a threefold division of what the Buddhism talks of the 31 planes, divided into 3. The same as raw material, 7 densities, 7 dimensions, I'd say. And Gautama spoke of it as freedom from this all, the all as this octave. That enlightenment is a radical freedom, and it involves breaking the 10 fetters, obviously. And thus, no freedom from identity and broken the eighth fetter of conceit, which is the deep mind belief in and momentum associated with craving ignorance that is supportive of or establishes even identity. And so freedom from identity or breaking the eighth fetter doesn't mean one becomes nothing, because nothing is also a conditioned state and not freedom from conditioning or freedom from becoming. So enlightenment as freedom from the thirst for becoming, freedom from all craving or thirst. There is a relative and absolute levels of truth as spoken by Nagarjuna, which itself is a relative level truth because it's conceptual, and the non-conceptual or absolute, the second level of truth in the Two Truths teaching, is beyond words. It's inconceivable. It's achintya. It's actually tat and sat from the Advaita Vedanta Hindu tradition. Tat as such or thus, and the phrase tatata is suchness or thusness, meaning reality. What one is aware of in complete and perfect enlightenment is reality beyond any fashioning, fermenting, beyond any conceiving, conceptualizing, relative interpreting. So that's absolute. So you can talk about it in relative terms, but it itself is beyond designation or differentiation. So in many cases or many ways, Lingzhi in the Record of Pilgrimages is going around seeing who's who, who knows what. And in the initial portion of the record, we see him still at Huangpo's temple, and then he does the pilgrimages and moves along. Just a moment. So he, like everybody, is speaking from the level of relative truth or conventional convention, human conventional perspective. But he's testing teachers and other students to see if they understand the absolute. I have to say, unfortunately, last week was a snake birthing day, and so I had half a dozen, nearly half a dozen baby snakes come into my room, one at a time. And what preceded my observance of the first one was something on the wall banging, hitting on the wall, because a baby snake had explored it, and then it was knocking on the wall, and now I just saw it moving, but I haven't seen any snaky black thing tube moving, which is how I can recognize them from 20 feet away. Then I have to pick them up and bring them to the the baby snake pool down the way outside. Really, this is true. And so this is good catalyst to get beyond 2.1 blockage, fright and shock. It's basically a body, deep mind, bodily reaction, shock, which is kind of normal when you see a 1 foot snake slithering and undulating as they do in my personal room. So that's possibly 1 week apart. It was last Thursday that the first wave of half a dozen came, and there may be a second wave of half a dozen today. Although the mother snake gets old, and I think that actually, as she gets older, the litter decreases from a dozen down to half a dozen. So if I say, whoa, 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 and I'm shocked, it means I haven't cleared the blockage, and another snake is coming through the room. So we'll see what happens. They don't appear when I'm looking. They appear when I'm not looking, and then I, out of the peripheral vision, see this black undulating, tube, and I know I have another snake to move to the pool. So, okay. When I turn away, it'll either appear or not. So, Lynchy is speaking obviously in common phrases. What are you doing? This is what I'm doing. But he's ever vigilant to consider whether just to see the mind of the other. He wants to see, and any great teacher knows the mind of those who approach. As we can see at a penultimate level with Nityananda, who could arrange all sorts of things by before he even meets the people who will be approaching him, in the near future. Before they ever approached him, he knew they would be meeting him, and then what was in their mind and their karmic disposition and what they needed, and how to arrange circumstances to help them before they ever came into his field of visual perception. Lingzhi is not quite like that, but manifests a certain kind of absolute freedom or freedom. He's certainly free from the belief that names and phrases are substantial and understands that the conventional is illusory. The conventional, not only customs, but particularly the perception-based world, the world of perception. What is beyond the world of perception? Well, there would be the reality beyond ignorance-based conceiving. So anyway, that's all very subtle. Let's just jump in. So record number 5, page 45 on the in the book, which is page 78 on the PDF. Record 5. One day Lin Chi was sitting in front of the monks' hall. Seeing Huang Po coming, he closed his eyes. Giving the appearance of being frightened, Huang Po returned to his quarters, the master, the teacher. Lin Chi followed him there and bowed low. That's it, that's the interaction. Then, the head monk was attending Huang Po. Huang Po said to him, though he's a youngster, he knows about this matter. This matter meaning the great matter, meaning birth and death, or freedom from all dukkha and reincarnation, the great matter of salvation, and the ultimate purpose for our being in this being, for our purpose of being here, which is, what is the ultimate purpose of creation? Well, one understanding of the ultimate purpose of creation, which is a discussion of teleology, the ends and purposes for which there is something. Is freedom. Ra said the original desires that entities seek and become one. Seek and become one, seeking to realize unity and realize reality and be free of binding and reincarnation and return to source. So that is this great matter. So the head monk attending Huang Po, having sort of aware of what just happened, Huang Po first says to him, though he's a youngster, he knows about this matter. Meaning, though he's in his 20s and young fellow, then the head monk replies and says, Venerable priest, or Dasher, your own feet aren't on solid ground, yet you give recognition to this youngster, said the head monk. Huang Po gave himself a slap on the mouth. And the head monk says, It's all right as long as you know it. That's it, that's the fifth record. What is that about? Well, what it looks like to me, number one, Lin Chi is sitting quietly in front of the monks' hall. Now, in general, in such a monastic organization, one shouldn't lazy about, and it's sort of like he's not doing his work, obviously. Was it a work time and he was sitting? Was it a rest time and he was sitting? Don't know. He's just sitting in emptiness or in his relative freedom, whatever freedom he had. Then the teacher approaches. He's testing his teacher. This is all IMHO, okay, in my humble opinion. So let's just dispense with that. IMHO Huang Po is approaching. He sees the teacher approaching. He closes his eyes deliberately. Why? To give the appearance of sleeping. To give the appearance of lazing. Why? Because he's testing the teacher. Why? Because that's the way he is. But testing the teacher regarding the inequality of responsibility, irresponsibility. Closing his eyes, appearing to sleep and doze and daze, doze and lays about and daze or doze, is feigning irresponsibility. He's feigning, F-E-I-G-N, feigning irresponsibility, to test the teacher to see whether the teacher is himself free of solid emotional investment in the polarity of responsibility, irresponsibility. How about that? And so, okay, he wants to see, is his teacher awakened enough to acknowledge that there's that they're both being responsible and being irresponsible are relative level conceptions and moral codes or recommendations that in his case are not relevant. They're relevant for people who are truly irresponsible, but he's not truly irresponsible. He's actually very serious about learning and teaching, or even helping, even though he was still a young monk and wasn't even out of the temple fully yet. He's not hurting anybody, and he's actually not being irresponsible. He's just resting, but actually he's testing. And Huang Po, presumably, he's testing to see, Huang Po, are you awake enough to not be stuck at the conventional level of perceiving irresponsibility? That's how I see it. And so these guys are not dummies, and they're very intelligent. Very intelligent, and they're working at several levels of interpretation of experience simultaneously. So he closes his eyes to give the appearance of sleeping to test his teacher. And then Huang Po, without skipping a beat, feigns fright. It's almost as if Huang Po knows that Lin Shi is feigning or faking irresponsibility and replies with a faking of fright. Very subtle, very high level. Very fast lane. So perhaps Huang Po can see, he knows Lin Shi had attainment. Final attainment? Probably not, but it's a solid attainment nonetheless. Attainment of emptiness, or attainment of the realization of insubstantiality and of freedom from names and phrases already. And that there is no thing to get. It's an attainment of no thing. It's an attainment. That is the realization that there's no thing substantial that could be got, because everything's anicca-anatta-dukkha, and you don't want to get, there's no getting thing or a state of awareness, something like that, isn't the goal. The goal is to be free of all craving, and thus free of the craving that leads to identity. Identity is a derivative of craving too, even if the craving is at lower levels of the fetters. Ninth fetter restlessness is associated with craving. Why is the beingness restless? And what gives rise to craving? Gives rise to conceit, identity, eighth fetter. There's some problem in the system, or there's some triggering of whatever one is, that it leads to a restlessness that associates with both craving and identity. And so the goal or the final attainment is a freedom from false identity. You can say moving from the S with the self with the small s to the S with the big self, with the S self with the big S, small s self to the big S self, which is not a personal identity whatsoever, but akin to the bright light that Lin Shi speaks of as the true man without rank. mm, Huang Po knows that Lin Chi has a real realization, solid, true realization. And then it seems he actually recognized that Lin Chi was feigning irresponsibility by and sleep by closing his eyes. He replies with a feigning of fright. "Oh, I'm scared of you." And then returns to his quarters wordlessly, saying nothing. So that is a Dharma battle, in a sense, although they deeply appreciate each other. Huang Po returns to his quarters. That's why Lin Chi followed him there and bowed low, in recognition of the teacher not skipping a beat, knowing the feigning and replying with another type of feign, or feint, feint. That's how I'd read that. Then the head monk, like the duty monk we saw in the last record, knowing nothing, I would imagine, as head monks commonly do or don't know much. Head monk is basically like general manager and should be a senior student, but that doesn't mean the head monk actually has attainment. It's sort of like the general versus the lieutenant colonel or the major in some military situation. The general has the status, but the lieutenant colonel or the major does the deep. Does, it really knows what's going on. It's sometimes like that, I think. So the head monk, who is like a general, little general, 2-star, 1-star, attending Huang Po says to him to test the head monk, to ascertain, to give the head monk another opportunity to develop further. Huang Po, the teacher, says, though he's a youngster, Lin Shi, he knows about this matter. That's what we're talking about here. This matter, this great matter, magnum opus. The great work is the great matter, is the essential, the fulfillment of the essential purpose for which creation is, for which we are here, for which there is consciousness itself, self-consciousness, is so that we may return to source and reveal, truth fully. Though, okay, so though he's a youngster, he knows about this matter. A head monk, like with a head down, looking. And how about you, Mr. Head Monk? Do you know? The head monk replies, "Venerable priest, great teacher, your own feet aren't on solid ground, yet you give recognition to this youngster." Your own feet on solid ground, not on solid ground, is probably a phrase of the day in Tang China. Something like, you yourself aren't stable, or you got knocked down over there in the previous case where the duty monk rushed in. It may be reference to that. You get knocked down, he knocks you down, or you fall so easily, just like you fell when he knocked you down over there. That may be a reference to that. Yet you give recognition to this youngster, so there's something wrong. You don't have your authority, something like that. Your authority is being challenged here, sir. Your rightful authority isn't hasn't been restored, is questioned, is questionable. Yet then further you give recognition to him. Why are you doing that? It undermines your authority further, even, sir, says the head monk, something like that. Huang Po gave himself a slap on the mouth. Now, Huang Po could have jabbed the head monk, but that's not really his style, and he was older. And you don't need to be aggressive or physical in, Dhamma battle, Dharma battle reply, or indicative of, radical freedom. It doesn't require shouting, of course. Huang Po gives himself a slap. He slaps himself. This is mocking. This is sarcastic. I don't think Huang Po is angry at himself. I think that he's saying, "Oh, my goodness. Oh, I'm so sorry." Like Brittany. Oh. That interview where she goes back into mind control. Huang Po gives himself a slap on the mouth. Oh, I'm sorry. Is feigning, feigning agreement with the head monk, because he doesn't, because presumably He considers the head monk a lost case right now, or too dogmatically attached to his perspective. He's too hardened in his perspective that the teacher deserves rightful respect by way of his position as an authority, and that that's right and true and inviolable. The inviolable moral authority of the abbot of the temple and the obvious, unquestionable disrespect of this young whippersnapper, Lynchy, and the teacher getting old and losing his grip and not being able to rightfully defend his authority in the temple, that's really what's happening here, thinks the head monk, perhaps. See, per, perhaps thinks Huang Po. Perhaps Huang Po sees it that way, or something like that. With that, if it's crooked, I leave it alone, said Chuang Tzu. So, this is a case, I think, of Huang Po seeing the mind of the head monk as currently unworkable. Thus, any kind of reply that would be addressing the ignorance of the head monk would be futile. Thus, he feigns shame or self-criticism, gives himself a slap on the mouth. Oh, my bad. Like that. But it's not really that, he's just faking it. And to further confirm that the head monk is clueless, he says, "It's all right as long as you know it." It's all right, meaning it's okay, venerable sir, older authority. I'll help you rightfully restore your authority. It's okay so long as you know that he's a young whippersnapper who has to be disciplined, and you are the supreme authority, and I respect that, and you should defend that, and I'll defend that, and I'm on your side here. All of this is conventional level experience, based on, conventional perception, conception. So perception, conception, experience. As perceived, so conceived, and as conceived, so experienced. We experience our conceiving of our perceptions, if you want to be linear about it. And while it's, reality and knowing and mind is not linear, linearity is Maya too. Sequentiality is Maya too. Time and space are illusory. Anicca-anatta-dukkha, the sunya. So the linear, is it linear or is it instantaneous? Ra talked about true simultaneity. True simultaneity is sort of the union, the identity of linear, sequential, one by one, temporal progression. And timelessness. Timelessness means all is now. There's nothing but now. All the apparent all many, all the apparent many, which is one, that appears over sequential phenomenal appearance, appearing, arising, persisting, passing away. That all of that apparent temporal sequence or progression is also illusory, or the result of, but that experience of time as linear is the result of limited perception. So with limited perception comes somewhat mistaken conception and thus experience. So rather than working on the head monk, Huang Po acknowledges the head monk is beyond helping in this situation, because he's hardened in his belief at the conventional level that there's nothing beyond the conventional level. And that all that's in play here, according to the head monk, is disrespectful young monk and an aging teacher who needs to be reminded to reinforce his authority over the temple. That's how I'd read number five. All right, number six, record six. Lin Shi was sleeping in the monk's hall. This is a serious boo-boo. Lin Shi was sleeping in the monk's hall. He shouldn't be sleeping in the monk's hall. Lin Shi was sleeping in the monk's hall. Huang Po came in, and, seeing him, struck the front plank of the sitting platform once with his staff, like, "You! Wake up!" This is very much like Daibo Satsu Zendo Edo Roshi. Edo Roshi definitely imagined himself akin to Lin Shi, I think, in some way. You know, one should not play radical freedom before one has been fully certified by one greater than oneself as fully radically free. I'm not. Edo Roshi was clearly not, but proceeded as if he were because... Uh-oh. Because... Okay, just a gecko. Today is the right kind of day for snake birth. It's just perfect weather, and... It was a week ago today that I had half a dozen, so I am hyper-vigilant to the wall, but it was just a curious gecko. Sorry, this is a dinner theater, so it's real. We're really eating dinner while we're doing theater. So, okay. So he's sleeping in the monk's hall. That is a serious boo-boo and definitely reprimandable. So Huang Po came in, I'll read it through, and seeing him, struck the front plank of the sitting platform once with his staff. Lin Chi lifted his head, and seeing it was Huang Po, went back to sleep. Huang Po again struck the front plank and went to the upper part of the hall. So he had been in the lower part of the hall. Seeing the head monk sitting in meditation, Huang Po said, "That youngster down in the lower part of the hall is sitting in meditation. What are you doing here, cooking up wild fancies?" So it's back to the head monk, and he's comparing him and reprimanding not the junior monk sleeping at the back, but the head monk in seat number one doing meditation. Now, can Huang Po see the head monk's mind telepathically and thus say, "What you're doing here, what are you doing here?" Cooking up wild fancies, meaning just sitting and thinking and dreaming as most people do commonly in meditation. Don't know how telepathic Huang Po was or is, but many of them are. So then the head monk replies, "What's this old man up to?" Then Huang Po struck the front plank once more and left. Later, Guishan, the kibitzers in the peanut gallery, Guishan asked Yangshan, "What do you make of Huang Po in the monk's hall?" Yangshan replies, "Two wins, one match." One match is it's Huang Po's match against or in relation to both Lin Chi and the head monk. One match, I guess, is, you know, it was this was related, what was happening at the back of the hall, Lin Shi sleeping and Huang Po not reprimanding him, and at the front of the hall the head monk in meditation, which is the proper form, which is, you know, commendable. Lynch versus Lin Shi doing something that is seriously not commendable or reprimandable, actually. It's a, you know, it's a breach of discipline. It's not a good thing in the, you know. But Huang Po, you know, confirms. He strikes the platform. Lin Shi lifts his head and seeing it was his teacher, Huang Po goes back to sleep, meaning he closes his eyes again. Because he knows there's no problem. And he, at this point, already knows that Huang Po knows there's no problem. They're both trying to teach the head monk, who has no idea what's going on, completely oblivious to the non-verbal communication between Lin Shi and Huang Po. So he thinks Huang Po is just an old man losing his grip. "What's this old man up to?" says he, meaning, what's happened to Huang Po, our beloved teacher? There's this young whippersnapper sleeping and breaking the Vinaya rules to some degree. And the teacher is not disciplining him properly. And he criticizes me. What's wrong with him? He must be losing his grip and becoming senile. I would think the head monk is thinking something like that. Meanwhile, Huangpo, doesn't reprimand either of them. Certainly not Lin Qi. He strikes the front plank once more and leaves. He's testing the head monk, who thinks that the older that the teacher is failing in reprimanding Lin Qi. This is very common in the record of pilgrimages later, where they're talking. You see Lin Qi approach somebody who is who's working from the conventional level, completely oblivious that there's something more in play, while they may be themselves a Chan teacher, leading hundreds of monks, not knowing that Lin Qi's even testing him, not knowing that Lin Qi's awake, not seeing Lin Qi's mind, not knowing there's a freedom, there is a radical freedom in play right there in front of them, not knowing what that is. Just like the head monk doesn't know what just happened, really, between Lin Qi and Huangpo. He thinks it's what's the word? Disobedient, law-breaking junior monk, not disciplined by our great teacher, who's an old guy losing his grip on proper monastic code, and having some sentimental attachment to this young rule breaker, who doesn't know his place. And Huang Po is basically testing the head monk, who doesn't even know he's being tested. Yet Lin Qi and Huang Po understand each other very well here. Two wins, one match is Huang Po and Lin Qi. This is not a win. They both won, you can say. The head monk loses. The two wins, you can say, are Huang Po's two wins, or Lin Qi wins and Huang Po wins. And it's one match, meaning it's all an extended Dharma battle. It's a testing encounter. That's why it's portioned off as one of the records, record six. So Lin Qi knows that there is no right and wrong in this case. He doesn't go around beating people, you see. He doesn't go around hurting people. This is so morality, freedom from morality is freedom from the moral codes that in fact are secondary, not cardinal sins, that kind of thing. Don't eat before noon, or don't eat after noon, or don't eat two meals a day. Like the story, two monks, it's China, walking for about to ford a river. There's a woman, there's no boatman or boat, and because the monks are prohibited, obviously, from touching woman, one monk looks at the woman and prepares to just walk across the stream with his buddy to the other side and leave the woman at the bank. However, the other monk picks her up, puts her on her shoulder, his shoulders, carries her over the river, through the river, across the river. Then he puts her down, says bye bye, and that's the end of that. And then the two monks continue walking, and sometime later, the second, who is looking quizzically and critically at the guy who carried the woman, asks her, why did you carry that woman across the river? You know that's an infraction and you've broken the rules. I have to report you. Maybe something like that, insinuating. And the first monk says, I don't know what he said, but something like the heart of the story is, I put her down at the river's edge. Why do you still carry her? Something like that. Now, a hardcore Vinaya teacher will say, that's a cute reply, but you broke the rule and you'll be punished. That's why some guys left the monastery, you say. Because they know more than the Vinaya masters. Vinaya, as one of the three baskets, Tripitaka, Sutra, Sutta, Vinaya, and Abhidhamma, the three baskets of classical Buddhist teaching. One is the sutras, 2 is the Vinaya rules and monastic codes, all the different sila-related rules and codes. And the third is Abhidhamma, which is includes commentary, so like the shastras. The Vinaya master will say, well, whatever you think, buddy, is fine, but you broke the rule and you'll be punished. Not knowing that there is, according to one monk, something higher than the law, the rule, don't touch a woman, which is the principle, be good to all. And he didn't generate desire necessarily picking her up and carrying her either. So there's the conventional level, which would be important, more is important. And scoundrel Roshis and Rinpoches, as we all know, flout the Vinaya, Patimokkha, monastic rules, monk rules, prohibitions, saying, I'm free, I can do whatever I want, and I want to serve all beings, and I helped her, it's usually a her, or my bank account, or the BMW in California. Claiming benevolence and non-obligation to the rules that everybody else has to follow, or should be choosing to follow. So, free or not free makes all the difference in the world. But this kind of thing was th this kind of dichotomy between those that have some awakening and those that don't. Those that understand the relativity, that there is relativity, that all of the thought and convention and codes are relative, don't steal is surely one of the Panchashila, don't take what's not given. Should I not steal when my baby is starving to death from the rich man who's fat and sleeping and drunk? Well, you decide for yourself. I believe there's something higher than don't steal, called to save the baby who's starving from the fat man who's drunk and has excess food that he's about to throw away. Yeah, I think so. Trugyam Trungpa said, somebody said, he said, if I were in the room where the man had his finger on the big button, the big red button of intercontinental nuclear thermonuclear exchange, I would kill that man, of course, said Trungpa, said somebody. So I remember. Maybe he didn't say it, maybe he did, I don't know. But it's that kind of thing. Murder is obviously a super serious cardinal sin, and the worst of the, it's a disrobable. It's one of the heinous, one of the, it's almost one of the five heinous sins or crimes in Buddhism. It's kill your mother or father is about that. Well, in this case, Trungpa claimed, or somebody said, he would kill that guy who had his finger on the button to destroy all the people in the world. Is that right action? Is it wrong action? I don't know. You figure it out yourself. But it seems to me, man was not made for law, but the laws were made for man. This kind of thing, which is who takes precedent, the man, or true human need, or law? Well, there'll be people on both sides who say, doesn't matter what you think, doesn't matter what you do, you help her, you don't help her, we don't care about your cute explanations. You broke the rule, you got to follow the rule, you broke it, you'll be punished, that's all. Thus apparently thinks the head monk and the duty monk. They keep order and don't know that there's a higher order associated with the with beyond what's beyond the relative and the conventional. Okay, all right, number seven, and getting close to the end here of the day. Record of pilgrimage number seven. One day during group work, Lin Shi was going along behind the others. Huang Po looked back and, seeing that Lin Shi was empty-handed, asked, "Where is your mattock?" Lin Shi replies, "Somebody took it away from me." Huang Po says, "Come here. I want to talk the matter over with you." Now that means
Let's get ready to rumble.
When he said that, "Come here. I want to talk this matter over with you." What matter? See, Lynchy knows that any human conventional discussion or specific matter is subsumed under the reality, within the reality of the great matter, birth and death, and awakening to reality now. So, Huang Po indicates he wants to rumble and says, "Come here. I want to talk the matter over with you." Lin Shi is like tingly all over, ready for the next Dharma battle. Lin Shi steps forward. Huang Po lifted up his own mattock. Mattock is something that you use for cultivating the ground. Huang Po lifted up his mattock and said, "Just this, people on the earth cannot hold up." So Lin Shi, Huang Po is testing Lin Shi. "Just this." When he lifted up the mattock, he said, "Just this, people on earth can't hold up." "What, the mattock?" "What, the curtains?" "Not the mattock, not the curtains. Just this." "What this?" "This reality here, do you see it? People on earth cannot hold up." He lifts up the mattock to simply, be dramatic. These guys are very dramatic, right? They like to play. They're theatrical a bit. Dharma battle is a bit theatrical. Lin Chi, Eido Roshi was super theatrical in the Dokusan room, with the high-end Japanese powdered incense in the background. Very, very theatrical. There's some value to that, I guess. Lin Chi stepped forward, ready for Dharma battle. Huang Po lifts up the mattock and says, "Just this, people on earth can't hold up." Now that's a challenge and a testing for Lin Chi. Just this means awaken to reality now. Reality awakening now. People can't hold it up. Actually, he's sort of testing Lin Shi to see, does Lin Shi, is he awake right now? And it's actually possibly even associated with, will you be able to go on beyond this temple without me? Are you prepared to hold this matter, to hold up this matter for all the world when you leave me? He's testing Lin Chi to see if he's prepared to go off on his own, I believe. Like that. Because this was getting closer to the time when before he left. "Just this, people on earth cannot hold up." Then, Lin Chi, ever the young whippersnapper, snatches the mattock from Huang Po's grasp. Right? Which is like saying, "I can do it." Snatches the mattock. Okay, I'll read it. Lin Chi snatched the mattock from Huang Po's grasp and held it high. "Then why is this in my hand now?" he asked. Huang Po then replies, "Today there's a man who really is working," said Huang Po, and returned to the temple. Got it? Working means in the work, doing the work, awake now and now and now and now. Desireless, identityless. There's no me in Lin Shi's talking, nor is there craving, actually. He's saying, I'm here now too. You're here now, I'm here now. Huh. Okay? This is what's real. And this, which is this great matter, which is now, here, now, is beyond names and phrases, and beyond craving, and beyond identity, and beyond karma creation. So Huang Po, recognizing Lin Chi's continued awakening, or pervading, durable and ongoing and solidly established, solid nothing. Solidly established awakened condition, Today there's a man who's really working, who really is working. Then the peanut gallery. Sometime later, Guishan asked Yangshan, "The mattock was in Huang Po's hand. How could it have been taken away by Lin Qi?" And Yangshan replies, "The thief is an inferior fellow, but in cleverness he surpasses his superiors." This is Yangshan's opinion that Huang Po was the greater attainment, the greater beingness field than Lin Qi at the time. Obaku Huang Po had many successors. Many got Sotapanna or more awakening triggered by Huang Po. Lin Qi, none. Nearly none, actually, as far as I can tell. And you'll see how he left the body in the abbot's room, surrounded by some senior students at the last breath. Just a gecko in the position of a snake. That's all. They like listening too, I think. So, the thief, meaning Lin Qi, because he's taking something, what did he take? He took awakening, but he didn't steal it from someone. He steals it away, and now is of awakening. I think it's more like that. I mean, he's not really saying, who knows what he's saying, but I don't think Yangshan is saying Lin Qi is a bad guy stealing things. No. He's a thief. It's a term of endearment. You young devil, like that. The thief is an inferior fellow, meaning Huang Po is the host and Lin Qi is still guest. But in cleverness, he surpasses his superiors, right? So, Zhang Su talked about something like the attainment of the sage versus the talent of the sage, or the achieve the life of the sage, or his the condition of the sage versus his talent. The talent is upaya, is skillful means, is one's capacity to lead others to their own self-awakening. I don't lead you, you lead you, we lead each other, we lead ourselves. Awakening, like healing, is a self-generated work. So there's self-healing, there's none other. There's self-awakening, there's none other. But there is a turning word, and there are healers, and there are helpers, and there are people who provide the ideal catalyst for self-healing or self-awakening at any one moment. So you can be sure that Huang Po, though he was aging, is, I believe, here the superior, but the attainment of the sage of Huang Po is greater. The cleverness, perhaps, of Lin Qi was greater. Whatever. But on the other hand, Huang Po brought to fruition many, many more students than Lin Qi did. So Yangshan says the thief in Lin Qi is an inferior fellow, not as great as the teacher in attainment. But in cleverness, he surpasses his superior, so he's very clever. Why, what does this mean, he was very clever or superior in cleverness? Well, it's how quick Lin Qi, you got to understand, I mean, we're sitting reading stories. These guys were right there in the moment. And, great teachers are very imposing, and they're kind of, they're not threatening, but like Nityananda said, like a jackfruit or some kind of fruit like that, not quite durian, but the jackfruit, spiky, dangerous, threatening, not safe on the outside, not cuddly, but the great teacher also on the inside, sweet and fragrant and soft and delicate. Yeah, totally, totally. The difference is, and the way to see a scoundrel is that they're actually not sweet and tender and soft and delicate and beautiful and lovely inwardly. They don't know that. They only know prickly or kick-ass or, proud, I'm big man, big abbot, big Roshi Rinpoche. They don't know. You can't see sweet and tender and delicate and gentle and harmless and lovely, beautiful inwardly. It's not there. So, but you can't just, you know, these guys are imposing. Wang Po is a big man physically, I believe. Like, you know, the last Karmapa. Big guys, like Dilgo Khyentse, the last Khyentse Rinpoche, who was not a scoundrel at all, as far as I can tell, was a serious, you know, looked like an arahant to me. Big type. You don't play around with these guys, and you don't steal things from their hands and do, you know, jump around like a monkey. So Lin Shi snatches the mattock from Wang Po's grasp, held it high, says, "Then why is this in my hand now?" The teacher is saying, just this, now, people can't hold up. Can you hold it up? And Lin Shi is so free, as far as I can tell, according to my limited freedom, he's so free that he could see what Huang Po is intending several levels beyond the verbal statement. He's saying, Huang Po is testing him and saying, this is a serious matter. When the teacher says, come here, I want to talk this matter over with you, you know you're going to get it. You're going to get something. He's not saying you're an asshole, I hate you, I want to beat you. He's testing. He's giving a heavy test. Which actually is not necessarily only associated with the fact that they're walking out along the dirt road off to the field with their hammocks and mattocks. And this is something bigger. He's actually, I believe, preparing to let Lin Shi go out into the world. And maybe that's true. If so, it looks like Lin Shi was aware that he's saying, are you ready to hold up this great matter without me in the world? And then this great matter is not the mattock. It's the mattock as a symbol of authority and, you know, pure verticality. Pure verticality, meaning I'm in the stream, baby, in the stream of the Tao, and root to crown to the great source of light, like that. The mattock as a symbol for perfect alignment with reality. Mm-hmm. The lower, middle, high is one rod of creation, held or demonstrated or carried forth by Lin Shi. Are you ready for that? He seems to be saying. Just this, people on the earth can't hold up. No, of course they can't. People don't know anything here. So Lin Shi says, I can do it. And snatches it and holds it high. Then why is it in my hand now? So because even this is symbolic, multi-level communication from Huang Po. Just this, meaning the mattock that he's holding up, the meaning of the mattock, not the physical mattock, the mattock as a symbol of rightful authority, pure alignment by one who's really finished and permanently in awakened state, broken 10 fetters. Now, I don't know if Lin Shi is there. I'm not there, but I think that's what we're talking about. And Lin Shi basically says, well, if you think people can't hold it up, you're wrong. I can hold it up. Then why is it in my hand now? Meaning, no, you're wrong. Some people on this earth can hold it up. I can hold it up. And he does. And because he read the situation correctly, or my reading shows this way, Huang Po says, this guy got it. He says, today there's a man who's really working, and returns to the temple. That means something, too. It means his work is over. His work is not supervising their work in the garden. His work is raising up awakened students who will become awakened teachers who will themselves help raise up another crop generation of awakened students who become teachers, and so on. So the light of the Dhamma doesn't die in this world. It's almost dead now. It's almost snuffed out now. There's not much of it. This is when I was in college, I wrote a song called The Decline of the Dharma. So very few true seekers, so very few in this world, we sang. So today there's a man who's really working. Yeah, right. And so that'll be it for today. Record seven. We're going nice and slow. And you'll see that Linqi is approaching his leavings. He's leaving Huangpo. So this great matter is a Chinese Buddhist conception of the primacy of attainment now, living free now, attaining that freedom now, that the great matter for all is the purpose of birth and death. There is birth and death. Why? What we are here and get born, persist, age, old, birth, old age, sickness, and death. Why? Why? Nearly nobody wants to answer that in this world full of cowards and liars and knaves. But fine. It's not a problem. So nearly nobody in the world wants to even look in at this great matter. Why are you here? What are you and why are you here? What are you and why are you here? I know that's important. You know that's important. Most everyone outside doesn't know that's important. Think it's not important, then they have their last breath, and then, ooh, aha, they see. There's something bigger than your little mind in play, bub. So, okay, cool. The Logos, is playing out some options. The chairman does experiments, and this degree of veiling, and this degree of quarantining, and this particular mix of souls on this particular planet is both seeking to raise up harvestables, or support soul evolution of itself, the evolution of logos in the form of self-conscious human beings. Okay. And, there's a vast sinkhole of indifference, Ra said, and the depths of distortions that infect these peoples, and the paucity of honesty. And, it's all perfect, with a whole lot of pain and confusion. Recommendations are being formulated, and I guess that's perfect too. So, in any case, that'll be it for today. Next time we pick up on record number eight, Linqi going to Guishan is another teacher, and again, Guishan was one of these two, right? The Peanut Gallery discussions after same Guishan. And I hope this has been beneficial to you. I hope you enjoy it and teach yourself well by way of this. Take good care. See you next time, and good night.